a 15-year-old scores for the San Jose Earthquakes. Will he play the youth? Will he not? Danny Hoosen receives his green card, and LAFC, the pride of the Western Conference, top of the table in town this weekend. It was also the international break. Lots of news and notes to sprinkle all around. So it is episode number 6 of Black and Azul, and it starts next. Thanks for tuning into another episode of Black and Azul alongside Joel Soria. My name is Charles Wollin, and headlines kind of surrounding Cade Cowell, who scored for the San Jose Earthquakes within a minute and a half of coming on against Monterrey. Just one of the most exciting moments in recent San Jose Earthquakes history, to be fair.
Yeah, youngest goal scorer for the San Jose Earthquakes, had an instant impact 3 minutes into the match. He scores, brilliant run inside the box, and just dices it right in the back of the net. You know, lovely start for him. It also obviously shows a lot about, you know, the Earthquakes' ongoing youth movement, what they really want to instill within their ranks. I think it's off to a good start.
The celebration was absolutely beyond imaginable for the young lad. The question is here, will Matias Almeyda play the youth, or will he not play the youth? A lot of fans have been calling for him to play the youth, and you know, you hear this across soccer spheres when a team isn't performing that well, and with the Quakes not gaining any points from their first three games, is it time to play the youth? Is it too early to play the youth? You gotta at least give this kid a chance again and keep him in the squad.
Yeah, like he said, maybe in 6 months we'll see Cade Cowell again. We will maybe see Gilbert Fuentes as well. Let's take it one step at a time is what Matias Almeyda is trying to say. For now, he has his 14 to 13 players, his senior players that he wants to move forward with. Jesse Fiorinelli and Matias Almeyda have a blueprint of what they want their youth setup to look like. It's going to take time, obviously, to really make that come to fruition. And for now, I personally would say don't rush it, you know, let it come in naturally like this preseason game did. It wasn't planned that Cade Cowell was going to come in and have, you know, a life-changing game, right? They were going to give him minutes. They obviously did. They gave Gilbert minutes as well. But they weren't expecting this. And, you know, these players are, in my opinion, ready to take on a couple of minutes here and there, maybe 15, maybe 20, but don't rush them. You know, like Matias Almeyda said after the game, you get that far too often with certain teams, and especially those south of the border, where, you know, 15, 16-year-olds show certain glimpses that they could potentially, you know, compete with senior players. And then after time, they start fading both physically and mentally. You know, this is a balance. There's a lot of intangibles here that a manager and an organization needs to balance. Let it play out. Take it one step at a time. They had their chance. They proved that they obviously have to earn minutes in the future. But yeah, just let it play out.
An organic experience. Moving on to the green card, the green card situation now for Danny Hoosen, which has seemed to be going on for this past month, dragged on and on, but finally it's resolved now. Danny Hoosen given a green card, opening up another spot on the team. So now the Earthquakes will have two roster spots to play with coming up this summer. There's already been a little bit of buzz about who they should sign. I know you've done some reporting, as well as Robert Jonas has a little bit of reporting, on this. And seems like the wind is back in the sails now that there's some spots open, and it seems like there's a little bit of pressure potentially now on the general manager, Jesse Fiorinelli, to go and get a couple players because they need a few.
Yeah, if I'm not mistaken, I think they have a roster spot open, only one. So 29 out of 30 are occupied, leaving obviously one open. But in terms of international slots, now they have opened one. Now they're at 7 out of 8. And as Robert Jonas reported, they are working to liberate that seventh spot in order to, you know, have two available come the summer transfer window. And these are obviously premeditated moves by Jesse and co, getting ready for the summer transfer window that is going to be crucial for this team if they have any hopes of making it to the playoffs. And off to a rough start, they're going to have to go and get a couple of DPs, at least one. They might be able to work with some discretionary TAM. That's if they haven't utilized all of their TAM. And it's, like I said, it's going to be vital. The team's going to have to go out. They're going to have to open up the wallets. They're going to have to spend, obviously, intelligently. That's the way that the Earthquakes like to run things, you know, Moneyball-esque signings. And we were actually, speaking of signings, we were able to talk to Isaac Brizuela after the game very briefly because he was close to the media. But I got to squeeze in a question in there asking him if he was potentially going to come to San Jose and reunite with Matias Almeyda. He said, let's see. Today, we spoke with Matias Almeyda at Vaya Stadium, and he pretty much shot it down. Said that Isaac Brizuela was a part of his plans. And the Earthquakes did approach and made inquiries regarding his salary and his transfer. Unfortunately, Chivas had him at a price that was way too high for the San Jose Earthquakes, and the San Jose Earthquakes obviously had to back out. So it sounds like Isaac Brizuela to San Jose is not going to come to fruition, at least anytime soon, because he recently signed a four-year contract with Chivas just a couple of months ago.
But who might they sign? Do they go in, you know, first of all, what do you think is the biggest void that needs to be filled on this team? And, you know, how do you think that they fill it? Do they, you know, try to get a game-changer type of player like Diego Villarri, you know, from an Argentina, you know, from Matias Almeyda's, you know, home country, or like a Baros Schiloto, who also is a playmaker, who also, you know, comes from that area, who also was, you know, very significant, you know, in this league, and now the coach of the Galaxy. I mean, you know, is that a player, that kind of fishing that you do, or is it, you know, bringing up somebody from another spot or somewhere?
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see which route they're going to take, right? It's very possible that the player is going to be Latin American. It's almost a given. It's not set in stone, but there's some inklings there that they're going to go back to Latin America. It's going to be, yeah, we'll see what's going to happen, but you could go for a mid-tier, leaning towards higher-tier Liga MX player, maybe someone within Chivas's ranks. But, you know, that said, Matias Almeyda could turn to his home country and go for another Argentine, or maybe they might try and find someone in the Brazilian league. Matias Almeyda is a very well-connected person, you know, within all of the South American ranks. So he knows players, you know, who play in the Brazilian league, players who play in the Peruvian league, obviously, as Marcos Lopez. They had no problems in going to approaching Sporting Cristal and picking up that 19-year-old there. But they can also go overseas and they can target European markets. Jesse Fiorinelli and, you know, the San Jose Earthquakes have resorted to the European market in years prior. I do know for a fact that the San Jose Earthquakes have a current agent in Italy who kind of monitors that market. Not only in Italy, but in the surrounding European countries. So it's going to be interesting. But I would have to say that the Earthquakes have to go for a DP. And they have to go for that playmaker, that game changer, that genius, either number 10 or that genius goal scorer, the perennial goal scorer who's going to change the trajectory of the San Jose Earthquakes. They're in dire need for it. And that's what they're going to need. They need someone who's going to, you know, bring this team out of the position that they're in and set themselves up for the future. At the end of the day, Chris Wondolowski's 36 years of age. He can't keep going on forever.
Yeah, now turning our attention to LAFC, who's top of the Western Conference in Major League Soccer, really kind of setting the bar quite high. And, you know, coming into this league, doing a nice job of branding themselves, a heck of a head coach in Bob Bradley that people respect, people like, people, you know, really appreciate his philosophy and just going about their business. Of course, they've, you know, have the Walker Zimmermans of the world, the Carlos Velas of the world, you know, etc. But LAFC, kind of a big test for the Earthquakes. They beat them in preseason by a scoreline of 3-0 in that match. Wando scoring in that preseason game at Bank of California Stadium. And so now the Earthquakes, having a chance to rebound, losing their first three matches regular season, going against the team that they beat in the preseason. But then again, they're top of the league. And if they can get a result, it would be huge. If they don't, I'm not sure.
Yeah, we're expecting a brilliant atmosphere out of Avaya Stadium on Saturday. LAFC always travels well. Obviously, the new Clásico, the new rivalry between LAFC and San Jose, this would be a crucial victory for the Earthquakes. I would even want to say that a draw would taste like a victory in this case. The Earthquakes are in desperate need of at least a point. It, you know, to try and stamp their game as well, which has been coming along, but it's not there yet. And LAFC are, you know, like you said, you know, they pose one of the biggest threats in the league. To me, they're the best team in the league, without a doubt. They have the best player in the league in Carlos Vela, a player that, you know, is a leader, a player that can score goals, and a player that has pretty much become that new Jovinko, where you just don't know what to expect. Charles, you did mention that the San Jose Earthquakes did beat LAFC in the preseason, and we got to speak to Matias Almeyda about that today. And he said that he wants to refrain from that game, and he wants to really focus on Saturday. It's going to be a completely different game. There's different circumstances, and they're going to try and play to their advantages.
Yeah, let's hear the quote. Matias Almeyda on what the Quakes need to do to win. In reality, we have to play our game and be superior in every way. We have to have control of the game and watch out for players that pose a big threat like Vela and their attackers. And so there you kind of see where his mind is a little bit. As you had just mentioned, you know, it's a blank slate, carte blanche, and you know, they've got their opportunity. They've got them at home, no less. And it's a rivalry, too, you know, since this team has come into the league. And, you know, he clearly sees this as it's a 3 points up for grabs. And if you're at home, folks, as you know, you got to take advantage of your opportunities when you're at home. And so what a better opportunity than now to be able to get some points. A tie, I think, would be okay for this team, especially if they can show some fight. 3 points would really do wonders.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm a little skeptical, though, heading into this game for one particular reason, and that's the international players who were absent for the majority of the week. The Panamanians were able to fly into San Jose midweek after their international friendly with Brazil. The Georgians, we're recording this on a Wednesday night, have yet to arrive in San Jose. That has me a little bit worried. Marcos Lopez, who was with the Peruvian national team, has yet to arrive as well. Then you had Jackson Yule joining the team today on a Wednesday, as well as JT Marcinkowski. And then you have Nick Lima, who is yet to incorporate to Matias Almeida's side. That's seven total players, 5 to 4 potential starters. Days prior to LAFC, who has Carlos Vela, he didn't play with the national team. To me, this is worrisome.
Yeah, I mean, I understand how you feel about it. For me, on my end, I think that these players get valuable experience being with their national teams, and it just takes one or two players to click with what happened during their national team break to bring something different to the group. You always want to keep learning. You always want to keep growing. And, you know, for this specific San Jose Earthquakes team that has lost their first three games, all they need is a spark, and it could be, you know, someone's confidence that they got from XYZ international match that they played. Or it could be, you know, seeing an old teammate or training well, but not actually getting in the team. So I understand that you're, you know, maybe jet, you know, there's a little jet lag and fatigue. I get that part. But on my end, I like it. I think it's good. Any sort of different changing up of the guard that we get here is going to be good.
I coincide with Matias Almeyda on this. This plagues his side. Okay, the players are coming in after a lengthy international week. Some of them, like I said, are going to be arriving just 2 days prior to the match. They're trying to implement a new system, a system that is vastly different from what these players play with their respective national teams. Against, you're paired up against the best team in MLS, in my opinion. It doesn't really, the equation doesn't look all that good to me personally. It's going to be interesting to see. Maybe we're going to see some kinks from Matias Almeyda, some adjustments to starting 11. Is that going to fare better than it did before? Possibly. Could it be disastrous again? Probably.
Well, who knows? We'll both be there at Avaya Stadium watching that match. San Jose Earthquakes versus LAFC. Kickoff time is at 12:30 p.m. Pacific time. Gates will open early, and kickoff is around 12:50 p.m. Now switching gears to the international break. We'll chat a little bit about the U.S. Men's National Team and about Mexico, because they were in town at Levi Stadium taking on Paraguay. But we start with the national team. We start with Nick Lima, that was not in the starting 11 for the men's national team. A little bit disappointing for Earthquakes fans. We would have liked to see him out there because he performed that role so beautifully in January.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, just unfortunate that he wasn't able to get in the mix there, give him at least 15, 10 minutes. It's valuable, you know, in that sense. But yeah, you know, Christian Pulisic had a wonder goal. The U.S. men's national team was able to hang in with Chile, who isn't going through their best times and obviously was also didn't have their best, you know, players playing with Alexis Sanchez and Claudio Bravo, a few of the players who didn't show up for the Chichichilele side. But yeah, I mean, the U.S. men's national team have made improvements, unbeaten still under Greg Berhalter, heading into the Gold Cup, who they're going to, you know, be rival competing with against Mexico, the two favorites, the two outright favorites for this cup. Who do you have in this? I know it's still early, but, you know, there's...
I have no clue. I mean, judging on the way that I watched it the other night, I mean, Mexico clearly is the kind of the class, but I wouldn't sleep on a, you know, Costa Rica, especially having a chance to play some matches at home in this Gold Cup that people probably don't know about. One of the venues is going to be in San Jose, Costa Rica, not San Jose, California. That will also be, you know, one of the featured venues. So I think it's going to be a fun tournament. I think there's going to be a lot more eyes on this one as compared to those in the past, and with two new managers for those two sides eager to win, both Greg Berhalter and Tata Martino for Mexico wanting to get that trophy, bring that trophy home. And we saw the Gold Cup featured on the end line in one of the pregame shows of one of the Mexican channels. It was just sitting on their stage.
Yeah.
You know, they're both going to want to win it. I'm not sure who it matters more to. I think probably I think Mexico has a little bit more pressure
rights at this time at this point in time, because there are no Confederations Cup implications anymore. That is long gone. These teams are just going to go out there and they're pretty much going to play for pride, for nationalism. Who's better, U.S. versus Mexico? I don't think Costa Rica has a chance, personally. I don't think any of the Central Americans stand a chance. Mexico is living through a good moment right now. So is the U.S. men's national team under Greg Berhalter. They're more of an uphill battle. Mexico has, you know, started running from the go under Tata Martino. We were able to watch him at Levi Stadium. They played phenomenal. First 8 minutes, they were up 2-0. Chicharito scoring. Raul Jimenez is playing out of his mind at the moment for Wolverhampton. Could potentially be Mexico's most expensive player ever. The rumors are that he might sell from Benfica to Wolverhampton or to another top European team for between 40 to 45 million pounds. It's a lot of money. Mexico, to me, is a clear favorite. We'll see what happens, but it's going to be exciting. Unfortunately, none of it is going to happen in the Bay Area. I would have thought that Levi Stadium was going to get right. get a piece of that tournament. They will be playing, though, in the Rose Bowl. Mexico will, at least. It should be good. International soccer in the summertime is always the best.
Yeah, note to Levi Stadium. When you host a Gold Cup final, I don't know if you're going to get a group stage game or a quarterfinal or a semifinal.
Last Gold Cup, the final was at Levi Stadium.
Yeah. And 2-1, Jordan Morris in extra time. Everybody kind of remembers it, Bay Area soccer fans as well. But back to the Mexican side, you know, there's a lot been said about the style that Tata Martino has implemented, as well as the depth of this team. That's why they are a favorite. They have hit the ground running, like you said, but Tata Martino, so much experience, Paraguay, Barcelona. He's just been absolutely phenomenal everywhere he's gone. He understands the game. He believes in playing really good attacking football, pressing, having your goalkeeper play out of the back. We saw that numerous times, as well. I was really impressed by the Mexican national side, more so, and I've seen them a lot in my lifetime, in the 2014 World Cup, and as well as in World Cup qualifying when the U.S. lost them 2-1 in Columbus. But this side has a different kind of feng shui about them, if you will, you know?
Yeah, they have a different flair. They have a different bite. I don't think you can really question Tata Martino's philosophy. One of Bielsa's disciples, he's going to get, this team the way that he wants them to play. And it's already coming to fruition, only 2 games into it. I mean, the sky's the limit for this team. But then again, they lose 1 or 2 games in a row and all hell is breaking loose. That's the way that the Mexican media turns it. So we'll, let's see what happens in the Gold Cup. If Mexico goes out and they win the Gold Cup, and I feel pretty optimistic about this new golden generation, because the past generation was a golden generation. This still, to me, is a golden generation. They still held on to that core, the core group of players. Obviously, you don't have Rafa Márquez anymore, but you have Edson Álvarez, who to me is the second coming of Rafa Márquez. And you have Chucky Lozano. You still have Chicharito, and you have Jimenez. I mean, this is a really good team, obviously. Diego Lainez, who didn't play well against Paraguay at all. He might go to the, under 20 World Cup. I would like to see him there. Let's see. Hopefully Mexico can make it to the 5th game. There's still a really long time before that, obviously. But yeah, it was a good spectacle at Levi Stadium.
Yeah, 50,000 plus at Levi Stadium, Bay Area, always very fortunate to have these international matches. Of course, the U.S. Here in January, Mexico here in March. Just a note for fans that follow Bay Area soccer, Chivas will be hosting Benfica on July 20th in the International Champions Cup, just announced, and that'll be at Levi Stadium as well. The Portuguese... many time champions versus
Portuguese
Chivas.
Giants.
Yeah, Portuguese Giants, Mexican Giants. It's we'll probably be there for that one as well. We want to make sure that folks get in the stadium when they can. It was a delightful time. Cool. So that's our show for today. I'm Charles. He's Joel. This is Black and Azul. Make sure that you like, subscribe, tell someone about our show. Appreciate you tuning in. And as always, thank you for growing the game of soccer in this country by tuning into this broadcast. That's exactly what you do. For Joel Soria, Charles Wollin, signing off.